Welcome back to another episode of Organic Chemistry. I'm That Chemist, and today we're going to continue the IOC series talking about carbon trifluoromethylation. But before we get into that, let's go through the practice problems I assigned in the last episode, which was quite a while ago. So in this first problem, we have this styrene, and through a multi-step synthesis, we want to make it into this diazo compound. So initially what we could do is we could do an epoxidation of the styrene using MCPBA, giving us the epoxide. Once this epoxide's been synthesized, it would be possible to use a Lewis acid to convert this epoxide into this ketone. A possible Lewis acid for this transformation would be something like BF3-ethrate. After this, once we have this acetophenone, all we have to do is treat it with tosylhydrazine, and this hydrazone is going to be easily formed. Upon treatment with base, this is going to afford us with this diazo compound. Now, the base for this reaction could be sodium hydride, but it could also be something a little bit milder, maybe like terbutoxide. Now in the next problem, what we want to do is we want to convert this alcohol into this ester and finally into this diazo compound. And so even though there's some more direct ways to get here, I'm going to propose a multi-step synthesis, first doing a PCC oxidation, which should give us this aldehyde in high yield, followed by a pinnic oxidation, which should afford the carboxylic acid. If you want to do a pinnic oxidation, you just have to use sodium chlorite in the presence of an acid, a weak acid such as like a phosphoric acid derivative. And once this acid's been formed, it's possible to do a Fischer esterification with ethanol. Now, if this was a more complicated ester than ethanol, I'd probably recommend coupling conditions like PIBOP, HATU, etc. But because it's such a simple alcohol, I would probably just do a Fischer esterification as shown here. Once we have this ethyl ester, it's possible to treat it with tosyl azide in the presence of a base such as DBU to afford this diazo ester product. Now in the final problem, I just want you to propose a starting material where we can convert whatever this is using an organic nitrite into this alpha diazo ester. And so if you recall from the earlier lecture, which I'll put a card to here, all we would have to do is treat this with some sort of amine. And so you can see instead of having the C double bond N double bond N, we just have a C single bond NH2, just an amino acid derivative, which is a derivative of phenylalanine. Okay, so let's get to today's material, carbon trifluoromethylation. So while there's many different ways to make CF3 groups, in this lecture I'm going to primarily be talking about the formation of CC bonds through radical, nucleophilic, and electrophilic trifluoromethylating agents. I will later cover in a different video all the other methods such as deoxyfluorination, desulfurative fluorination, etc. But for today we're just going to be talking about adding a whole CF3 group to other carbon-containing systems. So there's three different approaches, radical, nucleophilic, and electrophilic. In the case of radical chemistry, usually CF3I or Langlois reagent is used. In the case of nucleophilic CF3 addition, usually TMS-CF3, Rupert Prakash reagent is used. In the case of like aryl or cross-coupling chemistry, copper CF3 salts are the best source of CF3. And then in the case of electrophilic reagents, we have Umemoto reagents as well as Tony reagents. So in radical CF3 chemistry, there's some really old dirty methods, such as generating radicals with xenon difluoride in the presence of trifluoroacetic acid. Now the disadvantage of this is xenon difluoride is very expensive. It's also very, very reactive. And so the CF3 groups that you add tend to go everywhere and in unpredictable yields in most cases. And so a more recent development is the use of sodium sulfinate salts, which are then able to undergo desulfonylation to generate a CF3 radical. And if you'd like a review on this chemistry, I'd encourage you to look at this article here. Now, Langlois reagent was originally reported in this article. There's a recent review here, and you can see the structure of Langlois reagent, trifluoromethyl sodium sulfonate. And what happens is through a single electron transfer, which can be photochemical, it can be mediated by a photocatalyst, although other reductants can be used, we generate a CF3 radical through the extrusion of SO2. And so Phil Barron has a really good paper where they demonstrate the synthesis of several different trifluoromethyl derivatives through the addition of these CF3 radicals into heterocycles. And so in this case, you can see caffeine's used. There's a video on YouTube somewhere, and if you find it, I'll pin it in the comments, where Phil Barron shows that you can actually just take tea or coffee from the grocery store and in water do this chemistry, and you can still see by TLC that you get trifluoromethyl caffeine as a product. So this is quite a good methodology that even works on crude store-bought material that's been not purified. Additionally, they showed that you could convert melatonin into this 2-trifluoromethyl melatonin derivative. And so if you want to read that article, there's a link to that here. Now, there are other methods that can be used to add CF3. So in this paper here, which I believe is from the Macmillan group, they demonstrate that vitamin P, a vitamin I was not familiar with, was able to be converted into this trifluoromethyl derivative. I believe that this is called a calcone. And so in another case, you can see that a CF3 radical can be generated from trifluoromethyl iodide, which is then able to add into this siloenol ether in the presence of light, so photochemically mediated. Now, if we're talking about CF3 chemistry, the two main reagents that you'd see used are TMS-CF3, Rupert Prakash reagent, and some sort of copper CF3 derivative. Now, this one's was developed by Hartwig and co-workers. It's called trifluoromethylator, and it's commercially available. And since it's commercially available, it's probably the most convenient if you're just trying to test out some cross-coupling chemistry. Now, there are more reactive derivatives of this type of thing. And so typically the Cu with three CF3 groups is actually like the most reactive, but it's required to have a ligand to support that. Okay, so if you wanted to add TMS-CF3, this is good for 1-2 additions. So additions to carbonyls and carbonyl derivatives, imines, etc. However, if you want to do cross-coupling chemistry, that's when you'd want to use copper CF3. And so there's a good review for TMS-CF3 chemistry here and for copper CF3 chemistry here. And if you wanted to make use the best methodology for AR-CF3 formation using cross-coupling, you should look at this paper here. Okay. If you wanted to prepare the copper CF3 reagents, these are typically done from zinc CF3 salts, and those zinc CF3 salts can be prepared a number of ways, one of which is from TMS-CF3. Okay, so the way that an alternative approach is to generate CF3- using fluoroform. So fluoroform is dirt cheap, it's a gas, it's a little bit inconvenient for most wet chemists, although it is possible to work with it, and generate this KCF3 anion in situ. Now, this can eliminate to carbene, CF2 carbene, although this is also possible for TMS-CF3. So there's different conditions that are available, but TMS-CF3 would still be my method of choice. So if we wanted to add CF3 to a carbonyl, such as this Weinreb amide, you can see in this example that a trifluoromethyl ketone is formed through the elimination of this NO-methyl-containing derivative, which is the Weinreb amide moiety. And so what happens is initially TMS-CF3 is activated using cesium fluoride as a catalyst, and they form a hemiacetal type product. I guess it's also an aminal because the nitrogen's there. And then upon subsequent treatment with TBAF, that's converted to the ketone. Sometimes fluorinated ketones will form hydrates, but in this case, they isolated it as the ketone. In this other example, you can see that starting with this this propargylic ketone, they were able to add TMS-CF3 using tetramethylammonium fluoride as a catalyst. And then in a second step, they used TBAF to convert it from the ketal to the free alcohol. Or rather, not the ketal, but just the TMS-protected alcohol. Okay, so there's a couple references there if you want to see that. And I also have a reference here from a close friend of mine who prepared trifluoromethyl ketones from acyl phosphonium derivatives. And I'd encourage you to check that out here, as this is a recent paper. So in this example, you can see that a cross-coupling between trifluoromethylator and this heterocyclic iodide is easily converted into this CF3 derivative in high conversion. Additionally, they demonstrated that on this quinoline core, an iodide could be converted into a CF3 derivative. Now, there are other examples, such as the use of catalytic copper. So you still have to use stoichiometric zinc, and in this case, I believe they use 2 equivalents or 1.5 equivalents. But you can see that on this nucleoside derivative, it was cleanly converted to the corresponding CF3 derivative, even in the presence of a heterocyclic chloride. In this other example, you can see that this other heterocycle derivative was converted cleanly to the CF3 derivative in the presence of a heteroaryl bromide. So this is a good method, and this one was demonstrated on a gram scale. Now, if we started talking about electrophilic CF3 chemistry, it's a little bit more complicated. So there's a lot of nucleophiles in molecules, usually alcohols, amines, thiols, and a lot of those are going to be more reactive with the electrophilic CF3 sources than most carbon nucleophiles would be. And so a review of Umamoto reagent type chemistry is shown here, and then a review of Tony reagent chemistry is shown here, although these reviews are a little bit old and they don't recognize some of the more recent advances. Additionally, most of the types of CF3 forming reactions that are reported for these reagents is fairly obscure, and so I tried to just talk about a couple relevant ones in these slides. Both are more commonly employed for the functionalization of heteroatoms, such as thiols, as I was saying before. And so Umamoto type reagents have this structure with this like dibenzothiophene structure with a CF3. Typically, the counter ion is either triflate or tetrafluoroborate. And Umamoto has developed several different versions of this reagent, the newest of which is this OCF3 containing derivative. And the rationale for these is a combination of yield and stability. And if you look on Reaxys or SciFinder, this BIS OCF3 one hasn't been reported yet. as it's some of his recent work. Okay, so Tony reagents, on the other hand, tend to be hypervalent iodine reagents. And so the two early ones were the Tony alcohol reagent and the acid reagent. These ones are both commercially available, and they're also easily preparable using TMS-CF3. And a more recent reagent that they developed is this sulfoxime reagent, which they specifically developed for the trifluoromethylation of aliphatic alcohols. But because we're mostly focusing on CCF3 forming reactions, I'm not going to go into details about when you'd use which reagent. But for the most part, if you're doing C trifluoromethylation, you would only see the alcohol or the acid reagent used, especially as the sulfoxamine reagent is very new. Okay, so the downside of this this one is also it's not commercially available as it's brand new and it's many steps to synthesize. So some examples of the use of Umamoto reagent for C trifluoromethylation include this report by Governor and co-workers, where they use photocatalytic conditions to add CF3 groups to alkenes. And so in this case, you can see the terminal position was the only one that they observed. However, in some of their substrates, you also see addition to the less substituted, or rather the more substituted position, although typically the more sterically accessible site was favored. Okay. In this other case, you can see this work from the McMillan group, where you see the alpha trifluoromethylation in an enantioselective manner of aldehydes. And so you can see here they use one of the McMillan imidazolidinone catalysts in the presence of Tony reagent as the alcohol derivative. And so if you want to check out that paper, you can see that here. Okay, so hopefully this has been a useful lecture on the trifluoromethylation of carbon-containing derivatives. I haven't included any practice problems for this lecture set, as they tend to be more research-oriented. But when we continue to more topics that are accessible for undergraduates especially, I'll start including more practice problems. So it would really help out the channel if you left a like and subscribed, and I hope you have a great day.